Welcome to the first ever edition of Conformist Peach Cobbler. I am Brad Reed. I'm joined by Nugget. And Nugget, here's the thing about the name Conformist Peach Cobbler. People are like, well, what's the show about? It's about horror, like, you know, horror movies and, you know, like stuff that me and you do that's horror, like on the side, like, you know, serial kill and stuff like that. But,
well, this is evidence is what you just,
we'll keep it spoiler free though on that part. How about that? We'll just keep it vague. We won't, like, you know, it could be you that did. It could be me. I don't know. There's a lot of us in this group. So we're going to talk horror movies and stuff. So, but the reason that I wanted to talk about Conformist Peach Cobbler real quick, because it is the name we did go with, but how did we even come up with that name? Cause it was going to be like the name of our punk rock band back in the day. And I seem to remember like Heather being the, person who came up with that in a roundabout way.
Well, because we had seen a lot of, this is back when goth was, I wouldn't say it was popular. It's never been popular, but it was, you know,
it was hot topic popular.
Yeah. But we did a lot of, you know, cat rock shows and we'd see a lot of emo kids in, you know, out in festival 90 degree weather.
Oh yeah.
And all black and
sweaters.
We would make fun of them, you know, like, oh, mom, do you have to take me in the van? Like, oh, can you just drop me off like down the street?
Yeah.
And just make fun of these emo kids. And it'd be like, you know, Charlie, come to dinner. And like, no, mom, I hate your dinner. I will not have your conformist peach cobbler and your socialist corn or whatever, you know.
Yeah. Socialist corn. That'll be the next podcast. We'll do like all political talk on that one.
Yeah.
I like it. But this was like 10 years ago plus at this point. This was like maybe 15 years ago now that we
do you remember like we did a podcast as Conformist Peach Cobbler?
Did we do it as Conformist Peach Cobbler? I couldn't remember that. Yeah. Do you still have the audio for that?
I don't think so.
I don't quite recall like what we talked about on that podcast, but I think in 2021 it could have got us canceled.
Absolutely. I think it was just like a broad kind of a spectrum.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of like stand-up stuff I'd been working on.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
A lot of just stuff that definitely would have gotten us canceled or something.
Yeah, definitely. And so like, that was the thing. So we recorded a podcast. This was back, man, I don't even know. Like, I think at the time we were kind of like, well, we should maybe think of like a theme after we recorded that first one. Cause it was kind of all over the place. And so then I don't know why we just kind of like didn't do it. And it took this long for us to like come up with the most natural theme of all, horror pod. Mm-hmm. Because I mean, like I say, but speaking of like people overdressing, like the goth people, I remember the first show I ever did when I started working with you guys up at the radio station, it was Ludacris. And, I dressed up all nice. Cause I was like, well, what if I get to meet Ludacris or, you know,
You were hoping to smoke with Ludacris. Come on.
Yeah, of course. And so it was like, it was like my first ever. And like, y'all were like, why are you dressed like that? You know, you're going to be out here hot, sweaty. Cause it was at the Zoo Amp. And sure enough, that was the last time I ever tried to dress nice for an outdoor concert.
Do you remember that Ludacris concert at all? Like, do you remember the show?
Yeah, not really. Well, no, not really. Cause I do remember that, like, you and I ended up hanging out at the top of the hill in like this fortress that we had to build for the Wild Crew.
Scaffolding.
And I remember that we just kind of like hung out, like, just, you know, I think it was like the time that I was like, I think I'm this guy's best friend now, and I think he's mine.
I think I'll keep you.
Yeah. So what do you remember?
Yeah, I remember that. Well, I remember that you and I bonding at the show. Wasn't Mike there with us too?
Yeah.
Was that Mike or Steve?
Mosteller. I think it was Mike.
Okay.
Yeah.
We were all there together. And I remember the thing that stands out about that show is when Ludacris went on, I was really excited because I'm a Ludacris fan. And he got on stage. He did his like first three songs. And then he said, are we allowed to cuss?
Yeah, you can cuss.
He said, I bet those monkeys hate this shit.
Really?
When he's on stage.
Yeah.
Well, no, he said lions. He said, I bet those lions hate this shit.
Yeah.
And then he did his next song. I was like, what? Because it was at the zoo.
Yeah.
Which, if anybody knows Oklahoma City, the zoo amphitheater is right next to the Oklahoma City Zoo.
Yeah.
Like it backs up to it. So he said, I bet those lions hate this. It was awesome.
Yeah, it was pretty good. You know, it's funny. Have you ever been backstage at the zoo? I'm sure you have, right?
Yeah.
Have you worn the cat suit back there? Or
yes.
Yeah. Have you? Oh, God. Oh. Well, you know, they have the signs everywhere that's like it's a fine if you cuss.
At the zoo?
Yeah. Because they're like, you know, there's pretty good neighborhoods like right around, a pretty good amount of like just regular houses around there. And then there's, you know, the zoo, of course. So all the animals. Yeah. Because you hear, like I always like to leave a little early. So I'm always walking from the show as the last band's still on. And I can hear them playing as I'm taking that mile walk to the parking lot. And then I can also hear like the wails of all the different, because that's right over there is where they have like the dingoes and uh-huh. Yeah, they weren't having it. They weren't wanting to listen to Korn right then. Who will be a good guest on our socialist
Korn.
Yeah. So, but we, you know, you've been on the Nerdz to Men show, mm-hmm. which this is its own show, the Conformist Peach Cobbler podcast, but we are putting it out on our Nerdz to Men, like, you know, where I host all the other pods. And so you've been on there and we've done horror movie specials, but we're kind of talking about maybe doing this as a more frequently deal. Now that we've got the technology basically to where you can do it from your house, I can do it from mine, and it makes it a lot more convenient now too. So,
cause we live probably 30 minutes from each other. So
yeah, I mean, it's not bad, but it's just not, you know how it is. When you get home, you don't want to go 30 minutes elsewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I like this whole setup now. That's the only good thing that I will give towards the pandemic. Like, you know, we all started going home and watching movies at home, and that was more, that's how I enjoy life. You know what I mean? At home.
And if I can say, like, the whole Conformist Peach Cobbler, the first podcast, it was vulgar. Like, we were intentionally trying to shock. That's why I said that we would have got canceled back then.
Yeah.
It wasn't like, that's not even stuff I wouldn't say on a normal basis, but we are trying to be like, I don't know, shock jocks or shock podcasters. I don't know.
Well, it's because, you know, it's probably like the first thing somebody would do if they went from radio to satellite is like, well, how many F-bombs can I drop today?
Yeah.
You know,
can I cuss? Can I say, you know, awful stuff?
And, yeah.
Yeah.
But we should have done it back then because, you know, our podcast would be in its 15th year now.
I know, we would have been on the ground floor with like the Adam Carollas and the Mark Marins. I don't know if we would have Joe Rogans. The success of those, but you know.
Yeah. Well, who knows, you know. Some of the names that we almost came up with real quick before we get to the movie we're going to review today, which is Army of the Dead. Spoiler alert. If you haven't seen it, you better go watch it. But I had a couple that I wanted to share that we'll share some more as we go along. But one of them wasn't funny, but it was just one that I wanted to do was like Shock Theater, which was a kind of like, you know, a throwback to the Count Gregors and those, you know, Elvira, the people you would see host those movie nights where they show the B movies and stuff, you know, and it wasn't Taken, but I was just kind of thinking about that one. Then I was Interview with Two Vampires. I didn't get any feedback on that one, so I wasn't sure if you didn't like that one.
I don't remember seeing that one.
Oh, well,
did you send that one to me?
Yeah, I sent that one And the whole thing would be like that. We would dress up as vampires for every show.
But the problem is neither one of us are even close to looking like Brad Pitt or Tom Cruise. So.
Oh no, no. Like, are there no fat vampires that I could play? what's the, you know, there's the, what's the show from Taika Waititi?
We Do in the Shadows?
Yeah. I could be one of those guys.
With the fat vampire.
And then you could shave your head and be Nugs Feratu.
you right. Come on. Did you just come up with that?
Yeah, but you know, I it's not that I haven't thought about it before.
Nugs Feratu.
The one that you sent me that I really almost kind of wanted to go with it. The one time we met Rob Zombie at the fair, and I'll pop that picture up.
It's a long title.
Yeah.
But we did meet Rob Zombie at the fair.
We did.
At the.
Mm-hmm. And that was again, almost 20 years ago now. I remember we were fresh faced. Our hairlines.
Not a hair on our body.
Yeah. So
a couple of twinks meeting Rob Zombie.
I wonder if that's what he thought when we approached. Like, these twinks. That was pretty fun, though. I've met Rob Zombie twice or three times now. No, three times.
Ooh.
Yeah, but the first time was with you. It was at the State Fairground Arena.
And do you remember didn't he do, like, I have the picture up, but he did, like, a rock fist or something.
Yeah.
And like, I didn't know what to do, so I think I did, like, a fist pump or something.
Yeah.
It felt very, very, very unnatural.
I always feel weird because, like, you know, there people are always doing the, you know, the rock, the devil sign, whatever you call it. I don't know. My fingers are stubby and I don't think it looks as rock and roll on me as other people.
Yeah, two sausage tips.
Yeah. And then, like, I remember I took a picture with Hank 3 once with Blade Runner. He's like, let's flip off the camera. And I was like, that doesn't feel right either. I'm a nerd.
can I give a wave or a peace sign?
Yeah. What if my nanny sees this?
Oh, okie dokie.
Yeah. But we did. We looked very rock and roll there with Rob Zombie. I think I had the Halloween t-shirt on. And this was like right. He hadn't made the Halloween movies, but it had been announced. So I was like, hey, I'm so excited about your Halloween movies.
Yeah. So it would have just been House of a Thousand Corpses, right? That we were fans of.
Was that the only one? The Devil's Rejects didn't come out before the Halloween?
Yeah. Maybe Devil's Rejects first. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know the timeline there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, either way, I loved House of a Thousand Corpses so much that, and Rob Zombie's music. So I was excited, but I was hoping he might be like, oh, sure, come be in my movie. And I'd be like, yes.
You have a look that I like.
Yeah, like this instant connection. So
yeah, what if he just cast you as a fat vampire then?
I'm in for it. Somebody told me that a buddy of mine texted me not too long ago and said that, I don't know, I think it might be Rob Zombie who's involved with this, but they're bringing back the Munsters.
Yes, he is. He's going to do it.
So
he's going to remake it.
So, like, my whole life, I've been compared to Eddie Munster, like, because I have the tiny forehead and all that.
The widow's peak.
Yeah. I hated that. But right now, I would go with it. I would accept it and wholeheartedly, you know, run with it. If Rob Zombie will put me in this TV show as Eddie Munster.
Oh, it's a TV show, right?
Yeah. I think it is, yeah. Or when I get a little more older and a little more gruff-er, I could play Old Man Munster, like Old Man Eddie. You know what I mean? That'd be pretty dope, too.
Yeah. Like Logan, but with, you know, Eddie Munster.
Yeah. That would be pretty dope. Because, I mean, I'm starting
like he's trying to settle down and, like, he's got a 401k. Yeah. And like, yeah. He's like, you know.
Yeah. I like that. Cause you kind of have the same thing too. I don't know if it's just the radiation from the radio waves that preserved our faces, but people are all the time telling me you don't look 41, you look a lot younger. So I'm thinking I could play a younger, you know, like an adult Eddie Munster, but just in case I wouldn't mind going with old man Munster. That'd be fun.
Either that or Fat Vampire.
Yes, Fat Vampire.
Roast Feratu.
Roast.
Pot. That's all I got right now.
I mean, I love
it's pot. It's been a long day, Brad.
I love pot, so I'll go with it. I'll go with it. That's why we named it Conformist Peach Cobbler, because it's going to be horror movies with a twist of ridiculousness, I'm sure.
But it's really, it came from goth kids, you know, not wanting to listen to their mom and dad's rules.
Yeah.
So,
well, you know, we didn't end up starting the punk band. So, you know, there's still hope for that too.
Yeah.
In those 20 years since this has passed, I learned how to play the bass. I was in a band for a while.
I was going to say, you can play. I can't play any, you know, I guess I could be the lead.
If I could
don't
learn,
really need to sing to be in a punk band.
Nah, you could do that. Whatever. I got it all set up now, I think, where I'm going to just play both the guitar and the bass all at once. So
we'll just like put, Local H.
Yeah. We'll put Mosteller on the drums and then you sing and be real nice, Clark. Real nice. So, Nugget, are you ready? Are you ready to talk about Army of the Dead?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay.
You watch it?
Yeah. I've watched it a couple of times. Again, because we were kind of talking about this earlier, we were going to watch Army of the Dead and Spiral, which we will watch and talk about later. But I feel like I just am so spoiled now that like if I can't watch it at home, it's really hard to go out to the movie theaters. And I used to go to the theater all the time. You did too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We would do movie premieres for the radio station. I'd go every week.
Yeah.
Once a week.
Yeah.
At least.
Yeah, so we will watch that. I don't know if it's going to be if we might have to venture out to go see Spiral, but
I think it may be VOD soon. So
I'm hearing people aren't loving it, so that's not good. But
that's not good at all.
Yeah, I'm excited because Chris Rock is in it.
I know, I love Chris Rock, and I love that it's his concept, and I like that whole idea. And yeah. I mean, I was done with the original franchise, really.
Yeah,
I mean,
for sure.
It was time for it to wrap it up, but I still love the movies, so.
Yeah. Well, that first one too, man. Mm. Such an iconic movie, that one. But we are going to talk about Army of the Dead because smartly, they did release it the first week. It was in theaters only, which I would have actually liked to have seen like the IMAX version of that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. With Zack Snyder directing, the visuals were amazing.
Yeah. But I did wait the second week and watched it on Netflix. Did you do that or did you go see it on the big screen?
I watched it on Netflix.
Yeah. Did you? How many times have you seen it?
Just twice.
Twice? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Here's the one thing about Zack Snyder movies is I usually love them, but I don't necessarily love watching them over and over. And I think some of that is just because generally they're usually a little bit long.
Oh, yeah.
Which I don't mind long movies, but then it's just like, okay, well, I've seen this one. But with this movie, Army of the Dead, I feel like you could watch this movie about 10 times and find something new in it that you didn't pick up before because this isn't just your normal zombie tale. You know what I mean? That'd be cool, like a DuckTales, like a kids cartoon Zombie Tales. Woo.
Yes, it was 2.5 hours. I think everybody else that I've seen or I've talked to about it has said that it was boring, which I'm with you. I think there are so many details.
Yeah.
I mean, I could watch it over and over again. Like I just watched it the other day and I saw the scene where the first 5 minutes when that opening scene happens and they're looking over the horizon, you see UFOs.
Yeah. Yeah.
I didn't catch that the first time.
I didn't either. So, I didn't either. And then there were some things that like just in preparation for the show, I just got on YouTube and watched some people talking about things that they found. And I was like, how do you even have the time to like go like scene by scene and, you know, dig through everything. But thankfully that's what you got YouTube for, but you're right. There's so many things that are, in here that aren't just on the surface that, you know, he puts them in like little Easter eggs And like I call it like an onion, you know, you just got a bunch of layers there. So,
you're so deep.
Well, I mean, but that's the thing is you could watch this on the surface of it and still have a good time and not break down all these little things. You know, it's just a cool zombie movie that's set in Vegas. Or you can check out like all these things that are, some of them subtle, some of them aren't. And there's like a whole different world to this movie than you originally thought.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, let's start. Cause you said, in the beginning, there's two basically open sequences. The first opening sequence shows us how we got zombies, basically, sort of. Because there's a little bit of mystery. He didn't come right out and say, this is what's going on. But they picked him up from Area 51, the zombie that they end up calling Zeus. And like you said, there were the alien ships that were looked like they were kind of like overseeing this process or whatever.
Yeah, and the foreshadowing with the two guys in the cab of the truck and all that, and they're he's saying it's, you know, this could be the Holy Grail,
right? Yeah, because they're thinking they got an alien, which they might, because when they crash the car and Zeus comes out, he has dog tags on, so he's somebody who was a soldier, but he's got the zombie virus, and. Mm-hmm. Just that whole like sequence where, you know, including the aliens and then hammering it home, we might have an alien because we got it from Area 51. I think he's saying that this is a zombie, but not necessarily created like in a typical fashion, but like this is like some kind of alien human breed or something. But then, you know, it didn't go right. And so,
yeah.
What do you think? Is that where you kind of came like, is that the conclusion you came to?
Yeah, that's exactly that it was something alien, and that's why they were protecting it and so secretive about it. And that's why when the container opens, they're like, get away from it, you know?
Yeah, they were.
This is something they want to control. And, you know, they that's kind of foreshadowing for the final means to the heist, you know, what they're actually there for.
Right. Right. And then so like they take over Las Vegas, and then we get another like opening sequence that is very Zack Snyder with a lot of slow-mo. And
oh, it reminded me so much of the Dawn of the Dead remake.
Yeah.
With Richard Cheese.
Yes.
Singing Viva Las Vegas, just like he did Down with the Sickness in Dawn of the Dead, which is another amazing Zack Snyder movie.
Yeah, well,
I love that one.
Yeah, let's pause real quick and talk about Dawn of the Dead, only just to say that, like, you know, Zack Snyder, he's done the Justice League movies. He did Watchmen. I love that. 300. But I remember, I believe you and I saw Dawn of the Dead together, and that movie was such a badass zombie movie, and it had, like, humor in it, but it wasn't just, like, a satire, like Shaun of the Dead or something like that. But, you know, like when they're up on the top of the mall and they're picking off people that look like celebrities, you know, and all that. And so, yeah. So I loved that. And then later on when I was like, oh, okay. So that's Zack Snyder. He did that movie. That's awesome. So now you get like some of the stuff that was really cool in that movie. And then it's, you know, married to like his new kind of style of photography and stuff like that. Like kind of like what you saw with the Joker scene in this last Justice League movie where he recut mm-hmm. it and did that. Like he's using a lot of that kind of focusing and lighting and stuff in this movie. So his style is a lot more, I would say polished, but it's not like it's not polished. He's an artist with it, but yeah, I mean, he's more of an auteur this time around.
Yeah.
So coming back to Army of the Dead, we see a lot of different things happening. We see, you know, we meet Dave Bautista's character and then the people that he's trying to help. But one woman in particular I wanted to talk about first, it was her and her child. Like she was rescuing her kid out of Vegas. And as they're all trying to get out, you know, they're like dropping these storage containers. Mm-hmm. And she, her and her kid, after all of that, like, they get a horde of zombies catches them, and then the storage container drops on them. And everybody's like, why was that even in the movie? Because she, you know, it was an introduction to a character that we never really see or hear anything more about. And I think it was because it was, you know, it was basically foreshadowing that this movie isn't going to have a happy ending.
Well, he's also awarded the Medal of Honor for protecting. I'm assuming it's her. I thought it was that character that he protects all the way until the containers, and then they get crushed. Right. I think it's that character that he gets. So that's why he's down on his luck at this point.
Yeah,
it's because, you know, he wasn't successful. He, you know, now he's a line cook.
Right. Yeah. Well, and you know, kind of similar to Night of the Living Dead. You know, like, you think everybody's going to maybe make it out at the end, and then nope.
Yeah.
That doesn't work out.
With this movie, I thought the same thing, because there's a kid, you know, at the end, there's a character that makes it. We don't know. There may be more than one character that makes it. I guess there's two, and then there's a few that are unaccounted for.
Yeah.
But there's one, and he happens to be a black man, and you think, oh, this is going to end like Night of the Living Dead, but, you know.
And it kind of did, but not, you know, like, yeah. And we'll talk more about that here towards the end too. But the other, I guess, kind of similarity to me was, you know, here, I guess it's a virus still, because they can still make more zombies, but where it's caused by maybe aliens or something, like in Night of the Living Dead, you know, they were thinking it was radiation. And so I thought that was cool too. 'Cause like, he's doing things, I feel like, his own way now, like adding in the alien aspect and maybe, you know, and like robot zombies that you see.
Yeah, that's an interesting. Which, why? Is that just something he wanted to do a little different?
Yeah, I don't know. I think he wanted to have like different versions of different zombies, because you have like the alphas. They're the ones who are a little more blue. They look like they're the ones who have like the alien DNA in them, probably. Then you have the shamblers. And I thought the shamblers were funny, because like there was a whole bunch of them stacked up because they had dried up, and she had made mention, I think it was the coyote lady, that was like, when they get wet, when it rains, they like reanimate. I was like, that's pretty funny. I wish we could have seen that, you know, because that's a funny idea too. But with the robot zombies, Zack Snyder said he was kind of vague about it, of course, but he was saying that I think the idea is that they were put in there by the government so that they could walk amongst the shamblers and everybody and not be detected.
Okay, so, to kind of supervise.
So you made these robot zombies that realistic that then they're going to attack the people, like... like, that's a lot. I don't know. Like, maybe that is. Maybe the robots are alien tech.
Are you sure Zack Snyder's not like John Lovitz from SNL, where he's like, yeah,
that's the ticket. Yeah.
Yeah.
he
could that's why be. I did that. Sure.
Yeah. He could be, for sure. Because that's one thing I do like about Zack Snyder, is he leaves it open for interpretation. But, that's what I'm saying, is he's put a stamp on where you're like, okay, how many Dawn of the Deads, you know, Day of the Deads, all the different remakes and reboots and everything, how many much more can we do with this kind of storyline? 'Cause you know, you've got Walking Dead, you've got where their virus was from a space spore, that caused I guess the space thing isn't like completely original, but it does take it to a different place in the movies that we're not used to.
Yeah, he did that with Dawn too. He shows you a whole nother side of these worlds.
Yeah,
which I appreciate, you know.
Yeah, because like Dawn of the Dead, man, that baby zombie,
there's a baby zombie in this too. That's twice, you know, two baby zombies.
Yeah
and somehow zombie conception, which, who saw that coming?
Yeah, that's also, so that's why, like, who, okay,
saw that happening?
You know, Cameo, he doesn't watch horror movies, and he doesn't really like to watch zombie movies necessarily, because, you know, like, some of it's for religious reasons. He doesn't make any, you know, excuses about that. But like, to me, it's like, okay, well, if it's aliens and stuff like that, that's a whole different take. You can watch that, right? Because, I mean, you know, Jesus was an alien.
Jesus was an alien?
I mean, he's not from this world.
No, you're right. Yeah.
You know, you go.
Some people may say Jesus is a zombie, too. So,
ooh, see, zombie aliens. Zack Snyder didn't even invent it. Jesus did.
That's right. This all comes down to sweet baby Jesus in his manger.
Yeah. It's like, Jesus did it. like what was it? The South Park and Simpsons. Simpsons did it.
Oh, yeah.
First. Yeah. So, man, you can't do anything without Jesus doing it first, you know?
Okay. Can I just, I don't know if you're going to get to it.
Go ahead.
But
go
I don't
ahead.
Know. And I don't know if you read about it, but the whole concept of how they took Chris D'Elia
yes.
out of the movie completely because he got into a lot of trouble. Mm-hmm. He's a creep. They took him out of the movie and then put Tig Notaro in there all digitally.
Right.
Post-production.
Yeah. Millions of dollars.
She said she didn't meet any of the other characters.
Right.
Or actors. They just placed her in the movie. That blows my mind. Like, I found that out before I watched the movie. So the whole time I'm like, well, how do they, what? You know, like, how did they do that? I mean, there's some scenes where it's pretty obvious. Like yeah. she's by herself being shot.
Right.
Like
right.
no other actors are around her. But then there's scenes where she's in the group, like posing with the gun. And I'm like, how did they take a 6'2" man out of the shot and then put a 5-foot, I don't know how tall she's 5'5" or something
yeah.
into the scene without any sort of blemish. It looks completely like it was intentionally shot that way.
Yeah. So yeah. When I first watched it, I did not know that she had replaced Chris D'Elia. And, so I didn't, but I never noticed throughout the, you know, the thing. I think there might've been one time where I think he's talking to her at the fence and he's like, all right, bub. All yeah. right. And it's like, it almost doesn't sound like the same conversation is going on. That's the only thing that seemed a little off to me. And that was, but from the, you know, watching it the first time, not knowing, I barely could tell.
Yeah. I mean, that's why Batista only refers to her as him and her last name.
Right.
You know, to kind of, so they don't have to go back in and dub him in saying her, you know.
Yeah.
It worked.
It was really good. And then I don't know what Chris D'Elia would have been like in this, but I thought she was really good. So, although,
I think so too.
Although, I guess kind of jumping towards the end a little bit, because we're not, you know, we're not going to break it down like chronological order and have like, you know, one of these deals where we show all the scenes and all that. But, she is the reason that they got jacked up. They would have made it because she was going to leave. She was going to take off and she came yeah. back. But the few minutes that they could have saved there, the zombie, Zeus, he wasn't all the way up there yet. You know, they would have got away because he barely jumps on the helicopter. You see mm-hmm. what I'm saying? So it's her fault, yeah. really. Everybody's saying that she was the best part of the movie. Yeah, but she messed it up for everyone.
You're right.
Yeah.
I mean, that, or she could have taken off altogether and it would have been a whole different ending.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's true too. That's true. There's one big thing though, that I want to talk about for this, this movie. And so, when we're in, there's a couple things. So people were saying that the guy, Amari Hardwick, who plays Vanderho, there's a scene where they're introducing everybody in the credits and he's standing outside the statue of Zeus. And so people were saying, because he has this little thing where he's talking about how they're in they're in a time loop. Basically they keep repeating this over and over. And when he yeah. tells them that, if you're, and I noticed this in the first go round, like the skeletons that are laying around in the lobby there where they were had on, like they, one of them had her key necklace on and the other had Dave Bautista's like red bandana on. So, you know, again, with him saying it, like, and then putting it in your face, this is a time loop. I feel like this movie, what it's really trying to tell us is it's a video game.
Okay.
Because
like they're getting a new chance every time.
Yeah. And so like, because it did show them, it looked a lot like they had been there and died. And, you know, Zack Snyder has said, well, you know, they're in a time loop and this is the one where they finally got to the money, you know? So there might be that, but like, you know, we're in Vegas, there's games everywhere. You know what I mean? It's like, so there's that kind of thing to kind of hint to you that, you know, it could be a video game. And then they just did stuff like, do you play like Call of Duty, the zombies on Call of Duty or anything like that?
I haven't.
Well, so like if you're going and you're trying to get to each level, but like you're being chased by hordes of zombies. And so what you have to do a lot of times is when you're down to like the last couple zombies, you like shoot off their legs, but leave them alive. So they're crawling around and they can't like, chase you like fast, you know, like they still chase you, but they're crawling around. So you can go around and upgrade your weapons and do what you need to do. And so the way that they use the zombies in this, movie where they kept, sending them through like the booby traps and stuff, just kind of reminded me of that kind of thing too. Like just, you know, the whole video game aspect of it. So
yeah, that makes sense. Different levels.
Yeah, exactly.
Or so, missions, I guess they would be missions. Yeah.
Yeah. I think we're going to get some more movies coming out of this. I know for a fact that Dieter, the German fella who was the guy who was there to crack the safe, who had some great, great scenes where he was just screaming like a goat. So funny.
Yeah.
And then, but he's already, he directed and filmed and is done with it already, a prequel called Army of Thieves. And so that one's going to be on Netflix sometime soon, maybe by the end of this year. Or
it's associated with this movie.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a prequel. Okay. And then there's another prequel, I believe, that they're doing, which is going to be, it's called Lost Vegas. And it is, it's an animated, it's either going to be an animated movie or animated TV show, but I think it's an animated movie. So
these are already happening. These are things.
Yeah, they're already in development because he had already made this movie years ago. And, you know, Netflix finally picked it up and it was already ready to go. So
because who owned it beforehand? Was that?
I don't know if Warner Brothers did, because, you know, like he was making all those movies and he's talked about how Warner Brothers, he said, tortured him while he was making Justice League and stuff. And so I don't know. I don't know if it was that or if he just was shopping it around for a while and, you know, making it himself, because I believe that I read that this might, other than like some of the stuff he did with like the Joker in his backyard for the Justice League movie, this is the first time he's filmed in all digital, like red cameras.
Like he sought out these cameras.
Well, his friend is the guy who owns Red Camera. And so, you know, he's heard him talk about how he prefers the 35 millimeter or whatever, you know, filming it on, you know, whatever for IMAX and stuff. And so he was like, yeah, but you got to use these Reds, you know, I'll give them to you and you use them. So yeah. And so there's a lot of, like I said, there's a lot of cool, just director things that he does with the slow motion or the lighting and the, you know, the focus and stuff like that. So, but yeah, so back to Vanderho, they were saying that because of the way that it ends, they think, and because of this time loop thing, that he is Zeus, like he's the zombie we meet at the beginning. And I don't think I don't want it to be racial, but like, he's a black guy at the end. And I know that like their skin goes blue or whatever, but like this guy is growing long hair, like, you know, kind of like me or yours. I would think that that was a white guy that was originally Zeus. And then what I think more is what it represents is that Vanderho is the new Zeus in Mexico City.
Oh, like another game. another video game.
Yeah, yeah. And since he, you know, he got bit and he flew to Mexico City with that money, he's going to be the one that sets up like the king of Mexico City. That's a
cool idea.
Yeah, that's what I think is going to happen. I just don't see, I mean, you know, other than, no, I really don't. I don't guess I could see how he would be Zeus, like in the time loop, as far as we saw him at the end, he dies and it becomes the same Zeus. I think he's a new Zeus.
Yeah. A new boss.
Yeah. Yeah. So do you think we get an Army of the Dead Mexico City?
I would love that. Yeah. Yeah. I love this movie. So keep doing them. He does great zombie movies. They're entertaining to me. Like I love it.
What'd you think about Dave Bautista?
He's fine.
Yeah.
He's not a great actor. He's getting better.
Yeah.
You know, yes. He's getting better with every movie he does. And, sometimes his glasses were a little bothersome to me in the movie. Like it just didn't.
You know why I think he did that? So
why?
Well, because me and Cameo were talking about this, because I noticed this the second time I watched it. Me and Cameo talked about this on the Nerdz II Men show. Well, so Dave Bautista has been going around talking about how, you know, he wants to be an actor, you know, like he wants to be taken serious and wants to stop doing the action roles and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I told Cameo, I'm like, I get his reasons. I'm for it. He wants to do something different. Who's to say that he should do otherwise? However, you know, it just kind of starts sounding snooty when he's like, oh, you know, I'm too good for those kinds of movies. Well, you're still like the action star wrestler guy. You know, yeah. You haven't.
It got you there. Like,
yeah,
I don't know why you wouldn't keep doing it. You could be up, you know, with The Rock or John Cena or one of these guys that have made the transition.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, he just hasn't done that role yet to say, okay, this guy is like more of an Oscar type actor, you know? So, but he was saying that the only reason he took this movie was he wanted to watch Zack Snyder direct, you know, and like same thing with James Gunn. He's been watching him direct and all that. So I think he wants to do some directing of his own. So if you watch Zack Snyder, a lot of times Zack Snyder has those little glasses that hang around his neck. And mm-hmm. I think he did it as just like an homage to Zack Snyder throughout the movie. But you're right, because they were like these little like specs that, like, you know, doesn't seem like Dave Bautista is going to put on to like read the owner's manual to his AR-15. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I saw that too. Like, what? So is he got to like look up some recipes while he's cooking?
I know. You're like a little old lady with her cheaters on.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but I just wondered that. I wonder if he's doing that because I see Zack Snyder doing it a lot, like wearing those like type of glasses while he's, you know, probably looking over little details and whatnot.
Uh-huh. You know, he was supposed to be in Suicide Squad, the James Gunn version. And Bautista? He turned that down. Yeah, he turned that down to do this.
Yeah. I wonder who was he going to play, the guy that Cena's playing or somebody else?
Oh, maybe, yeah. I bet that's probably the role.
You know, since we're talking about basically WWE guys or F or any of those guys who turn into actors, The Rock, you know, probably the most successful, I would say. He's not a great actor either, but he picks great roles for him. And yeah. So, John Cena though, like, I feel like he's coming up as an actor. I don't know. I mean, maybe not so much as an actor, but he picks good roles and he's funny, like really funny. What do you, have you enjoyed any of his movies?
I've noticed he plays a good straight man, like in that, Blockers.
Yeah.
He had the jorts on. He kind of played like a lame dad, which, yeah. You know, I don't know. He's still a huge dude. So I don't know if I buy that.
But. Yeah. Right. What was the, he played the hockey player with the female comedian. I can't think of her name. She got blonde hair.
Oh, Amy Schumer.
Yeah. 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 I thought he was really funny in that movie too.
And he's in, the Tina Fey, Amy Poehler movie where they throw that party and he plays the drug dealer that shows up.
Yeah. So like he might not win any Oscars, but I think John Cena's doing pretty good too. And you know, these guys, they have to act for their day job for the WWE. That doesn't mean they're good actors, but they know how to act a little bit. But I just wondered if you see Dave Bautista like being like the front man of some kind of dramatic movie.
No, I mean, I don't think so. I don't think he's a leading man. I think he does. The roles he's picking are pretty good for him.
Yeah. I love him as Drax. I really love him as Drax. Yeah. He's hilarious. And then with this one, it's not like they gave him a whole lot to do as far as an actor, being an actor, but this one was good enough that I felt like he didn't look like he was faking it or he didn't look out of place.
I mean, he was even able to like cry on screen.
Yeah. Yeah.
At one point, that's pretty good. Yeah. Not bad.
Yeah. He did okay. I thought he did good. So, I just kind of wanted to break that down and see what you thought about him. Better than Hulk Hogan and
Holds Barred.
Yeah. No Holds Barred.
I don't know. Or Rocky. Hogan's great in Rocky.
Oh yeah.
Nah. What is he? Oh, his name in Rocky is iconic.
Oh, you're talking about, oh man, I can't think of it. Let's see. Hulk Hogan in Rocky.
It's like,
let's see. I'm pulling it up right now.
All right. Well, if I could just say, there's another thing that I read about that was taken out of the movie. Snyder wanted to put a scene with a stripper zombie, a male stripper zombie with a bite taken out of his penis.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he cut it out of the movie.
Yeah. I was wondering about that because they said it got cut out and I was like, well, isn't Snyder the guy that decided that on this one, since he didn't really have a studio, or was Netflix like, nah, we can't have any bitten off dongs.
I mean, there's like 20 boobs in the movie, but we can't have a,
Yeah. Yeah, but you have
a donger in there.
You see some boobs. A donger? You see some boobs. You're like, that's cool. But you see a bitten off dong, and you're like, ow, ooh, yeah. Ow.
I don't mind it.
Yeah,
you know.
Well, you hate your dong.
Whatever.
What? You had to go to therapy for that, you know. Thunderlips.
I knew it was something with the mouth. It was.
That's your new name
Thunderlips.
Now. Thunderlips.
Thunderlips.
Man, that'd be a great DJ name on the radio. Like, I'm Thunderlips.
Yeah. Brother. Oh, did you also like the Theo Rossi character?
Yeah.
It was so Romero-esque, like how, you know, he put Ty Burrell in Dawn of the Dead as the jerk. And so Theo Rossi plays the jerk in this one.
Yeah.
And he does a great job.
I love Theo Rossi.
Romero and, I mean, in this case, Snyder, they create these characters that you just can't wait for them to get killed.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like, and then because I really like him and other stuff that he's done, you know, Luke Cage, he was in Luke Cage. And then of course, Sons of Anarchy. Did you watch that? Mm-hmm. Did you watch him in Sons of Anarchy?
I didn't. I saw Luke Cage though.
So he was Juice. And he ends up going to prison with Marilyn Manson. It's pretty, he gets like an interesting storyline there at the end of the show. But I've really enjoyed Theo Rossi. And like, yeah, he was a total dick in this movie. So, you know, you wanted him to get moited for show. Mm-hmm. Did he end up, you know, we did say spoilers. Did he end up getting killed or was it just turned into an alpha?
He got turned into an alpha and then he got killed.
Oh, yeah.
Real quick. It's like there was all the, you know, there's this guy's going to last a while because you got to have that jerk in the movie. And then he gets turned into an alpha. And then there's his final scene with the Batista's daughter. I can't remember her name. And it was the coyote. Does he face off with the coyote, right?
Yeah.
And then she murks him. And then that's, you know, that's it.
Yeah. Man, this is crazy. Hey, doggies.
Sorry.
That's a zombie dog.
Zombie dog.
Yeah.
Zombone.
No, it's all good. We got all love for dogs and on this pod, on all the pods. But yeah, so I want to run another theory
you
by
said,
you.
You said paw.
So I want to run another theory by you, because okay. We saw that the guy did live, and he's going to Mexico City, right? And some people were saying too that he had the same tattoo that Darkseid has in the Justice League movies, but yeah. I was watching a video where that he's had that tattoo for a little while. So that didn't actually tie. It didn't tie into anything.
So the actor himself has that tattoo.
Yeah. Zack Snyder was like, "Hey, your tattoos are great. We're leaving them in, you know, they look like what your character would have." So, okay. So when he comes out of the vault and he's got the cash and they had just dropped a nuke, which was hilarious, by the way. That whole setup was funny because it was like, they're going to drop a nuke on 4th of July because the president, they didn't say who, but I could imagine a president that would say, because it's pretty cool, you know?
Yeah, I caught that. That was a Snyder, like, who's our most entertaining president in the past few years?
Yeah, so, but then, of course, they had to move it up, you know, which is very video game-like as time was running out. But so he comes out after the nuke and
yeah,
so you,
no radiation, by the way, like, wouldn't there be?
Right. Right. That's exactly right. And so people were saying he wasn't affected by the radiation 'cause he had been bit.
Okay.
And of course it took him a while to turn. Like, he didn't just die right away, but he had been bitten. And so because he was a zombie basically, or going to be a zombie, that's what protected him from the radiation. So if that's the case, then wouldn't that stand to reason that it, like, who didn't get hit directly by the nuke, that there would still be zombies that didn't die in Vegas, right?
Yeah.
So yeah. So we still have a whole lot more world building to go, is what I'm trying to get at.
There's people in the helicopter at the end that we don't know what happened to them.
Yeah.
There's two people in particular that you don't know what happens to them.
Right.
So there's still more story there.
Yeah, because you assume Dieter got killed, but Zack Snyder, when they were talking to him about it, he goes, if you don't see somebody die on camera, ... And then that was all he said. So, so some of those people definitely, if you didn't see them die, could still be alive for the next movie. But again, like I say, with Dieter, he's getting the prequel, and then we're getting the Lost Vegas, which is all pretty cool, man. I'm excited.
Yeah.
Very excited. I don't know. Like, there was a couple of things that I feel like he only took things from Dawn of the Dead thematically. I don't believe that it's really the same universe. I mean, I know it's two different places where we've had zombies, but I think they're two different stories. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, this is a whole nother world where they actually contained it. And whereas the Dawn of the Dead is just, it's all over.
Right, exactly. And, like, I feel like Snyder is subtle and not subtle. So, like, I think if he wanted us to know it was connected, we definitely know it was connected.
Oh, yeah. There would have been some sort of, you know, tie-in to Dawn in some way.
Yeah. Now, he did do the Richard Cheese and stuff like that, I think, as an homage. And some people thought that the van, you know, the battle van that they made to get out of the mall, they thought that there was a scene where you could see that van, and he said it wasn't the same one though. So I feel like if he's saying that it's not, you can probably guess, you know, you can believe him that it's not.
I bet in a lot of these directors that do horror or comics or something, people pick apart their movies where they're like, I didn't plan on that, but sure.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Just a happy little mistake or whatever. Just kind of, yeah, I agree with that. So yeah, I don't know. I feel like out of three severed zombie heads, I'm going to give it three severed zombie heads.
out of three.
Yeah. Yeah. Three out of three.
So you really liked it.
I really did. I mean, I can't think of too much that I could say was wrong with it. You could nitpick some things in every movie, but I just felt like it had a lot of style. It had a lot, there's a lot of fun to it. and it leaves a lot open for your interpretation and for other people's interpretation. I mean, he might not necessarily direct everything, because like I say, the guy who played Dieter directed this prequel. So, you know, he's just saying, hey, have fun with it. Throw it out, you know.
And great music, too. Like, I loved all the Elvis songs, the Richard Cheese version, of course, and Suspicious Minds by Elvis, and Bad Moon Rising. It was like a slow cover of it.
There was a great cover, and then there was also a scene in the movie. Did you catch it? That was a direct, almost, you know, it almost played out exactly like it played out in American Werewolf in London, where they're like the two guys at the beginning and they're running out over like the desert and one of them falls and he says something to him. And that exact thing happens in American Werewolf in London when they're out like on the moors or wherever they are in London or in England.
I didn't even notice that, but that's the same scene. And I also read the scene, I can't remember the character's name, but the one who gets killed first in the group. And she gets left there by the guy that works for the guy who sent them there.
Yeah.
That whole scene is an alien.
Right.
Like whatever you want to call it. Like it's paying homage to that.
Yeah. 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 There's a lot of that, which I loved. She actually was in Justice League. She plays one of the Amazon ladies. So.
Oh, that actress does?
Yeah. Yep. Not maybe, Justice League, yeah. Maybe she was in one of the Wonder Woman movies too, I don't know, but she was definitely in Justice League, so.
But he does really good. I didn't like the music in Justice League, but, or the Snyder Cut version, but like the zombie cover.
Yeah.
The Culture Club, the Do You Really Want to Hurt Me?
Yeah.
I thought that was cool.
Yeah.
Or the End, the cover of The End.
Yeah, which they were, there was some stuff like that too. So like that was a homage to Apocalypse Now. Like there was a lot of stuff in there that like references other movies that are like, you know, like Apocalypse or different, you know, different things like that. There was a scene where the helicopter's flying into like the sun basically. And that's another kind of like scene from Apocalypse Now. So. Yeah, there's so much.
That's why it was 2.5 hours long. He tried to fit every single, you know, reference to another movie in there.
Yeah. That's what I love. I'm sure I can watch it again and be like, oh man, there was something else. I got to tell Nugget about that next time. So yeah. What do you think? How many, severed zombie heads would you give it out of 3?
Are we okay? The scale being like Shaun of the Dead or Night of the Living Dead being a 3 out of 3.
Yeah.
And then like Resident Evil 17 being,
or the zombie head. The day of the what was the movie with John Leguizamo? Where they also had
Land
of the Dead, where they had the smart zombies in that, but I wasn't like buying the smart zombies in that. I thought the way he does smart zombies in Army of the Dead was way better than whoever came up with that concept for Land of the Dead.
Yeah, those last few Romero ones really stunk it up. Like Island of the Dead, Diary of the Dead was okay, but
I guess I didn't mind Island of the Dead so much, but it was not great. It was kind of dumb. I don't even know if I watched the last one though on Netflix.
I'll go ahead. I'll say 2.5.
2.5? 3. Okay.
Yeah, half a zombie head.
Yeah.
Which is a thing that, you know, happens.
Yeah, it does.
If it's the lower half.
There you go. Didn't they do that? Didn't they pull somebody's jaw out?
Yeah, ripped his jaw off.
Ugh, so good. The gore was so good. Is it bad that I think that kind of stuff is funny now?
Oh, yeah. Like them using the machine gun to shoot the zombie into pieces.
Yeah.
I love that.
Oh, yeah. That was great. That was great. I think what was
in the opening sequence. That was great.
Yeah. I loved it. I love that movie. I thought it was really good. So I recommend everybody watch it. So like I say, coming up, we're going to talk about Spiral Saw. Hopefully we talk about it. If it doesn't come out on video for 6 more months, then it might be a minute. Then we got The Conjuring, which comes out on HBO Max. So we'll definitely be all over that one. Do you like to watch haunted movies at your house?
Yeah, I don't mind it.
I prefer to watch them at theaters because I don't want to bring that shit home.
That bad juju.
Yeah, like have you ever been watching a movie, like a horror movie, where something like weird happened while you were watching it?
Yeah. You ever seen the movie Terrified? Not Terrifier.
Terrifier. Oh, not
Terrifier. Terrified.
Okay. I haven't. I don't think so.
It's a ghost anthology. It's set in Mexico, and we were watching it, and it's really good. It's on Shudder, I think. And we heard like something land on the roof on the other side of the house. And we were both like, I had to get in the attic. There, it was a whole thing,
dude,
because we're all amped up from the movie.
That's scary. Well, the last time me and you did a podcast, I think the lights were flickering on and off during the pod.
Yeah.
And we were talking about ghost hunting, no less. And then, so one time, when the very first time I saw The Craft, I was in high school, right? And we were at my buddy's house, you know, stoned to the bone.
Mm-hmm,
sure. And like during the peak, you know, like of the movie where lightning's crashing and all kinds of stuff's going on, like at the very peak, all of the power goes out in this house. And my buddy lives on like a lake. So we're at this like lake house out in the middle of nowhere. And I was like, hell nah. Hell nah. Yeah. So that one was pretty scary. All right. Cameo. Nugget.
That's all right. Yeah. Call me Cameo.
When I would do shows on both Kiss and Cat, like it would always be a struggle because I'd be like, 98.0, Rock 100.5, the Cat. It would suck. Nugget, just real quick, what are there any more movies that are coming out that you're really looking forward to? I got one. You want me to give mine?
Yeah, go for it.
It might be the same one. Candyman.
Yes. Absolutely. Jordan Peele.
I cannot wait for that movie.
I know. I'm super excited. Like, is he directing it or is he just,
I believe he's directing this one. Yeah.
Okay. I didn't know if he was overseeing it or he was directing it or what. So
yeah. Yeah. Either way.
It looks awesome.
Yeah. I can't wait. I wonder who's going to play Candyman though, because like Tony Todd's iconic because of his voice and everything, you know what I mean? Like, so have you heard of who's going to play Candyman?
As far as I know, it's still Tony Todd.
Oh, it is.
Yeah. But it's less of a up in your face kind of thing and more of like about the urban legend. And he's not really like, I don't know if they aged him down or what, but I think it's Tony Todd.
Oh man. So now I'm even more excited because that's awesome. Like Tony Todd, I haven't seen a whole lot of stuff that he's been in lately. It was not too long ago. He was in The Flash and he was like the voice of what was that guy's name? Zoom. He was basically, he had the all black Flash costume. And the guy that was actually the guy playing him wasn't Tony Todd, but they had Tony Todd do his voice, you know, when he had his mask on and he's all scary, you know, and
yeah,
I didn't even do it justice, but Tony, like I was trying to figure out, cause I like, he made that scary. You know what I mean? If you would have met Tony Todd in, you know, some alley in Cabrini Green right after that movie came out, I'd be scared as hell.
Why does he have that coat on? It is way too hot for that coat.
So I didn't realize
and the bees.
Part of it. That's pretty
so
dope.
Many bees.
Yeah. Yeah. Smells like honey. So yeah, that's the biggest one I'm looking forward to. And then I know there's another Halloween movie coming up soon. Did you watch the last one?
I did.
Yeah.
And this one is, I think, Halloween Kills.
Yeah, I believe so.
Is the name of it.
Are you excited about that one?
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I thought I guess they never showed him die in the last one, but
yeah.
So, I mean, he can always come back if the movie's a success. I thought it was done pretty well.
So
the most recent one.
Do you think, I think I've heard some fan theories lately that Michael Myers, Jason, but I think especially Michael Myers is also like an ant, like a robot, like some kind of android. Like after the first movie, he was replaced with one, or and then they point to the third movie, which was Seasons of the Witch, which didn't really have Michael Myers in it. Have you ever noticed that, or would you have put that together? Like, would you think that he's some kind of android?
Well, don't they kind of get into that with, like the Paul Rudd movies and all those, like 4, 5, and 6 is like, he's at one point he's like controlled by a society that, you know, that I don't know if they send him out to, I don't know what it is, but those movies all kind of blur together for me. The 4, 5, and 6,
to me, it would make sense, though, like how he keeps coming back, you know. So we'll see. It's funny, like, which ones we are canon now and which ones aren't, because in H2O, he gets his head chopped off.
Yeah, and he kills Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yeah.
In 7, in Resurrection, he kills her.
Yeah. And then she's back. They did say, though, with that one, you were supposed to watch, I think, 1 and 2, and then this one was, like, supposed to come after that and all the others were retconned or whatever. So
yeah.
But I thought that the last movie was okay. It had the potential, but I thought if it had like Rob Zombie's balls, it would have been a better movie. Like when when he escapes the bus, right? You don't actually see that. If you would have seen him rampaging through the bus, like, you know, kind of like Darth Vader style at the end of Rogue, or Daredevil style in the hallway, or you know what I mean, like that tight quarter kind of fight, that would have been dope. But instead they just kind of were like, it happened off screen, and I was like ugh. So that was my feeling on that.
Yeah I liked it. I thought it was pretty good.
Yeah,
I get what they're doing, the direction they're going.
I'm hoping the next one's really good. Also,
I mean, set up for like another one after that. So
yeah. Cause this one's kills. And then, yeah, there's one more. All right. Well, you know, Conformist Peach Cobbler will be around to review them when they come out.
Yeah, exactly.
Or yeah, we'll record this one and we'll do the next one in 15 years.
Yeah. We'll retire the name now. And then we'll come back.
Yeah.
When one of us bothers the other one enough to where we do it again.
Oh yeah. I think that's what happened. I'm like, Nugget, you ready? Nugget, you ready? Nugget, 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 Nugget. And you're probably like, fine. Let me talk horror movies with you. All right. Well, listen to Nugget every weekday on the Joey and Heather Show on 98.9 Kiss FM. And anything else? You got any stand-up comedy shows or...
No.
Anything you want to plug? Your OnlyFans?
Yeah, check out my OnlyFans. I do tastefully nude stuff.
Tastefully nude.
Yeah. I mean, depending on how much you give. If you give a good donation, I mean, I'll go completely classless.
Yes.
I'll show everything.
See,
the whole.
That's what women, they make all kinds of money on OnlyFans. Dudes, they're not making no money because they would just give it away, you know?
I mean, I'll show you the BH, whatever you need, whatever tickles your fancy, as they say.
Yes, whatever tickles your fancy. All right, we better get out of here before this turns into like a porn pod.
Yeah.
Conformist Peach Cobbler, the porn pod. That'd be cool, though. We could review porn. I don't know. Maybe not.
I mean, it would take us forever to review.
Yeah, we're on season one. Of all the porn.
Yeah.
That'd be fun though. I could get down with that. Maybe we'll do that like when we run out of horror movies to talk about.
The porn pod.
Yeah.
The porn cast.
Yeah. There you go. All right, Nugget. Well, have a good week. I will talk to you on the next Conformist Peach Cobbler.
All right, Brad. Peace.